Give it a second for attendees. I'm off the wait list. Okay. Hi, everybody. I'm going to call this meeting to order today. And just to explain why I am calling to order is our president, Kate Parker, is going to stay just for the first hour of the meeting. And I'll serve in her place as president pro temp for the rest of the meeting and now. So that's why I'm calling us to order. So we'll go to the next agenda item, which is the Pledge of Allegiance. So could we get our flag up, please? All right, so I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. And then I lost my place. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America.
And to the Republic.
And to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, indivisible,
under God,
indivisible, for liberty and justice for all. Lost my place. I'm not feeling well today either. I got a bit of a cold. Could you do roll call, please, Palmina? I think everyone is here. All right, we're going to go next to longevity recognition. I'll pass it over to Dr. Maria.
So what we do in this portion of the agenda is normally the board recognizes the people who have been here for many years. And this time we have somebody I got to spend some time working with, who is Victor Bryant, and has been at the district for 10 years of service. He is the catalog schedule specialist, and he is supervised by Jens Yu Kuhn. And congratulations, Victor. It's been a pleasure to work with you.
Thank you, Victor, for all you've done for the college, 10 years. We're going to do next item 2.6, items to be taken out of order. And we're going to take item 14.1, which is the United Soccer League / Santa Barbara Sky Football Club La Playa Stadium facility rental update. So Dr. Muir, I'll turn it over to you.
Okay, at this point in time, I'm gonna turn it over to Vice President Moss, and I believe Peter Moore is also supposed to be here.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Murillo. I believe Peter Moore is here. It would be great if he could turn on his camera. I think he's here so that we could actually see him. So thank you. We wanted to use this opportunity to bring an update to the Board of Trustees on the work we have been doing with Santa Barbara Sky Football Club and Peter Moore. He is their owner and lead investor in the Santa Barbara Sky Football Club team. We have brought this information the last round back in March to the board. And after some time has passed here, we wanted to bring the latest update on where we're at with them. We've continued to work through them and discuss the concept of them renting La Playa Stadium from us for their games beginning in March of 2024. That's one change that has occurred since the last time we came and spoke to the board. Previously, we were working with them towards a March 2023 date, opening date, and now we're looking at March 2024, which we appreciate that extra time, which we'll need as we work through the potential negotiations with the contract and also the improvements that the team is looking to invest in our stadium, our lighting specifically, a new scoreboard, bleacher seat upgrades. We will need our time to make those improvements. So we're happy that it's pushed back to the following year. So that's one primary update since last time. We do continue to work with our legal services team on drafting the contract and finalizing that contract. And the one item that we have agreed upon at this time is the primary piece around the rental rates and the revenue sharing specific to parking and concessions. But we do have a handful of items that we're continuing to work through, including in the contract language at this time, which is the specifics of the funding and the management around installing a new scoreboard, stadium lighting upgrades, and the bleacher seat upgrades. Also, the specific schedule, the temporary modular seating that they're interested in having around the field, and a number of specific details that will be listed in the contract around the facility use during each of the games and the management of the games. So that's my update, but we have Peter Moore here to answer specific questions about Santa Barbara Sky and what they're working through. So if the board members have any questions, he's ready for us and available. Thank you for being here, Peter.
Thank you, Lindsay. Thank you, members of the board. Good to see you again. It's been 4 months since we presented, and a lot has gone on there. As Lindsay said, we got to terms of agreement from the president's cabinet after presenting back in two. Paul Miller was very helpful in working with us, and Griffith and Thornburg, I think, are your external counsel who we're working with just to finalize all the details. As you recall, back in March, our views with the stadium, we absolutely adore the location, and obviously it's an iconic place for us to be able to play. We are focused right now on the floodlights because, as you recall, these games are televised nationally on ESPN Plus. The current floodlights, and I've contracted with a consultancy group that are looking at them right now, 70 candles. There's a question about their environmental efficiency, the ambiance of the lights. For high definition TV, they need to be more directed towards the field, and that's something that we're working through now. We're optimistic that we'll get the report back within the next week or so, and that it won't be too difficult to simply put more environmentally conscious lighting, more lighting that is focused on delivering a high definition TV signal nationally, as this, I say, will be an ESPN broadcast. Secondly, we're looking at seating and seeing how we can upgrade the seating, both, as Lindsay said, modular, where we can put seating in, maybe on the opposite side of the field for people to be able to get a little closer to the playing surface, but then, of course, taken down for use during the week for PE and athletics. And upgrades, obviously, to the bleacher seats, where we feel we can upgrade some of those wooden seats in particular, because we do believe that based on some of the velocity since our announcement of season ticket inquiries and deposits, that we're looking at a crowd of about 4,000 to 4,500 for our home games here, both men. Probably won't be able to get that for our women's team, but we're very committed, as I mentioned during the last board meeting, to bring in a women's team here as part of Santa Barbara Sky. Reaction to the announcement has been tremendous, both locally, regionally, and nationally, and it's put a great spotlight on Santa Barbara. I will be providing the board a media audit update that we have commissioned next week that will show the quantifiable and qualitative impact of the announcement here that Santa Barbara is going to get a professional soccer team. As Lindsay said, unfortunately, we were running out of time for 2023. Our focus now is March of 2024, which is when League One kicks off. And as you might recall, it's a regular season of March to September. If we, which we hopefully will, make the playoffs, that will be in October. So more than happy to take questions. A lot of work to be done. Good start for us so far. Much to be done over the next 18 months, including getting players, coaches, sporting directors, technical staff, front office, and everything. But I think the reaction that I certainly have received from the local community in particular, people invested in helping in bringing this to market, has been gratifying. And I'm optimistic we're going to have a top-class team here in Santa Barbara in 2024 and beyond.
Thank you, Mr. Moore. Do any board members have questions? Looks like we have Trustee Gallardo and then Cronin.
Thank you, Jonathan. Well, first, Mr. Moore, just gratitude and saying thank you. I was out of town and was unable to make it to the Moxie event, but I think the press coverage was amazing. And most specifically, I want to commend your vision for seeing how this will impact children as young as 8 years old in our soccer divisions. It is difficult to get field time anywhere these days, and specifically the terrible time the children have had across the state and across the country, and the huge campaigns that have been launched with parents with Let Them Play. So I think that your vision is extraordinary. Any improvements that you want to make to the field, I think they're a win-win for the college, for the community. Everybody here on the board knows we are not flush with cash. So having your partnership, Mr. Moore, to invest in something that is going to impact athletics for everyone, in addition to providing upgrades that the college to be honest, would not be able to do without your vision to bring this to us. So I just want to say you have my full support. And goodness, if at this point, if you can do anything for the flag football kids, because unfortunately, Santa Barbara Unified, if you read that article, they don't have a field at the junior high. So I thought, hey, and Mr. Aldana, that was my former student, that young child that was featured there. So anything you can do, I am a partner because I am a fully supportive of sports and athletics and the academic and just mental health and well-being that that contributes to students and to adults and everyone alike. So thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Gallardo. And interestingly, you know, Randy Rouse, the mayor, was with us at the Moxie, and he and I have spent some time together over the past few weeks. He's a former rugby player, so he gets the benefit of team sports. He said, my number one problem in town is finding playing facilities for the youth. You know, this is, he sees this obviously as the pinnacle, what we're looking at Santa Barbara Sky. Our goal is to try to find places around town where we can add more playing fields, not just for soccer, but for, as a former PE teacher, you might recall, you know, I am totally bought into your vision of what this does for the community here. And it's our hope that we're able to contribute more than just at the high end of soccer.
Awesome. Thank you. And thank welcome. You. Glad to make Santa Barbara your home.
Thank you. Thank you. It's a pleasure and it's an honor.
Thank you, Trustee Croninger.
Thank you for joining us, Mr. Moore. I appreciate your being here to answer questions. I, as a board member, was more than a little surprised to read your announcement that you were going to be playing at La Playa, since we don't yet have an agreement on that. Did we miscommunicate there?
I don't know if we miscommunicated. Obviously, I got the email that the president's cabinet had tenderly approved. As I mentioned, we're on tight timelines to deliver. This is a massive undertaking. It's been 4 months since I presented to you. We came to an agreement on April 19th in writing that we had tentative approval. I engaged, because I have no staff, I engaged with Griffith and Thornburg, with Felicia Torres on all the details. And we are, you know, doing all of the papering up of the contract. If this was to go any longer, this would be 2025. You know, unfortunately, I know you're all invited. Nobody was able to attend, and I was saddened not to see a single board member there. Members of the civic community, the commercial community, the soccer community, the sports community were all there, Santa Barbara City Council. But it was sad to me. I wish you could have seen the reaction that we got. But there's no miscommunication. Maybe, you know, there's a leap of faith of getting this done based on everything that I am working with, both with from my side as well as with the external counsel that has been retained by Santa Barbara City College. Just to get, this is not a complex deal. It's a two-page deal that was presented that is simply a annual fee that's guaranteed in $5,000 for the men, $2,500 for the women per game, plus a 50% rev share of parking and concessions. Obviously, all of the details that Vice President Mas detailed were the stuff that we're going to make the most investment is in the stadium itself. I couldn't really feel that anybody would be against us investing in Santa Barbara City College La Playa Stadium. So we decided we were going to go ahead. Again, everybody was invited to the announcement. So, and I'm assuming that there will be no issues going forward here, that we'll all look back on July 12th as a monumental moment, that La Playa Stadium, Santa Barbara City College, the board of directors, the mayor, the Santa Barbara City Council members who were present, and members of the community that were present, 125 people, and the press that we have got that shows Santa Barbara, the City College, the stadium, the environment, and the community in such a positive light on a national stage.
Well, I certainly appreciate your enthusiasm, but a heads up would have been appreciated on what you had in mind. My view of this is that it is a complex contract. There are a lot of moving parts, and I would suggest that the board have a closed session to discuss its view of the terms of the contract and the things that need to be thought about before we come to conclusions here. So we can have a closed session on that, either a special meeting or a regular meeting anytime, but I think that would be important. I'm also noticed that your contract with ESPN is about 3 years old, and you said it looks like you would be up for a new one. Is that the case in August?
I am not USL. I try to make this point very clear every time we talk. So the league is the United Soccer League, which is an operation based out of Tampa Bay in Florida. That's USL. I have nothing to do other than the lead investor in putting Santa Barbara into that league. Now, as you will all have seen, I'm sure, MLS, which is the league that sits above us, has just renewed its deal with Apple TV for $2.5 billion. I cannot believe, and I'm not privy to USL, that's a 10-year deal for streaming rights on Apple TV for MLS, Major League Soccer. I'm not privy to the negotiations that ESPN and USL are having because it's none of my business, but they will keep us updated. I can only believe that there is a bidding war for USL based on A, what they're seeing above with MLS. In particular, if you follow soccer at all, you saw the three Premier League teams were beaten by MLS teams last night in preseason friendlies, which has kind of shocked the world. And secondly, just the burgeoning size of media rights for soccer, particularly in this country, as we then move towards the World Cup being played here in 2026. I can find out, Board Member Croninger, whether there's any doubt to whether this deal will be done. I have to believe that not only will it be done, it will be done on better terms, and there will be more than ESPN bidding to show USL.
Well, I'm interested for sure, and including the financial terms, because I think our own financial terms are affected by that. So if you can find that out, I'm sure we would like to know.
Absolutely.
And that's something we could discuss as well, you know, at a closed session. So thank you for that.
Yep, most welcome. Thank you.
Thank you. Trustee Miller.
Thank you, Jonathan. Mr. Moore, also welcome to our meeting. We appreciate you being here. My comments are similar to Trustee Croninger's. That is, I was very disappointed in the local press because it gave a very clear message that we had made a deal with you, and there is no deal. That deal hasn't been made. There are more questions that I have than answers. I haven't seen any of the terms that have been even tentatively agreed to. I just don't know what they are. And so I have an open mind about whether I would approve this a deal or not. I also know that the athletic department and the PE department have concerns. Maybe those concerns have been resolved at this point, but I don't know. I know their concerns were significant and lengthy. I think they come first in our consideration of doing a deal for minor league soccer on professional soccer to play at the La Playa Stadium. So I'm not going to go into all my unanswered questions here. I think a lot of those are more appropriately discussed in a closed session, as Trustee Croninger indicated. I think we have more work to do before we can reach an agreement on this. I have one question, though. You quickly mentioned an approval on April 19th. What is the approval that occurred on April 19th?
I don't pretend I understand the communication flow of the administration of Santa Barbara City College as regards approvals for finances, and I don't know what the president's cabinet is, but on April 19th, I received an email. The president's cabinet has tentatively approved the most recent financial proposal you provided, which I did a month before that. We will now go to external counsels to start drafting up a document. So I don't know what the president's cabinet is, Board Member Miller, and I don't know how that works. I'm not a board member, but I took that as a green light based on the back and two of negotiations between Paul Miller sending us out a very good draft and then coming back with my idea of that, which was, here's our guarantee, here's our flat fees, here's our rev share on parking and concessions. The usual rental agreements, of which I'm sure you've seen plenty, that are tied to a La Playa. So I don't know what the president's cabinet is. I don't know if the board of directors have input into that or visibility of that, whether it's something separate to the board of directors, but on April 19th, that's what I received.
Okay, so it may be that you don't understand then that the Board of Trustees has the final decision on this matter.
I'm not a board member. I don't understand, as I said, how the administration and communication flow of approvals works. You've outlined that for me, and I don't know what the president's cabinet is. And I would say that this is not a complex affair. We're investing in La Playa Stadium. I think it needs some investment. I'm more than happy. Certainly I'm writing from my own personal checking account all of the costs imbued in that, because I believe in this community. And this is a soccer town, and I believe in La Playa Stadium, and it deserves an upgrade. And I will certainly corral the people in this community that are willing to contribute to that. Now, if the terms and conditions are for whatever reason, are not accepted, then we've got a different conversation to have. But I think the challenge for me, Board Member Miller, is I've got to get this moving. We've lost a year already. It's been 4 months since I presented exactly what I just presented to you. If it's going to be another year before we get approval or we're turned down, then that's a different story. I am so hopeful that we can bring professional soccer to this town and that La Playa Stadium would be the venue to do so.
Well, I likewise hope that we can reach a mutually agreeable agreement, but I think we're a long way from that at this point. Thank you. Can I
step in for two?
Yes, please, Dr. Maria, go ahead.
I think it needs to be clarified that the president's cabinet is the executive level management of the organization. And what occurred was that Vice President Moss brought negotiations, pieces that we've been working on with Peter regarding the rental fees, et cetera, to the president's cabinet. And we felt like from where we were, that they were acceptable terms for the rental fees, and that we could then move forward to negotiating out the rest of the particular items with our attorneys involved, because we had dealt with the issue so that the actual college staff needed to move through before we could work with the attorneys to do all of the terms and conditions. So it was the president's cabinet did say, let's move it forward to the attorney for the rental fees that we have worked really hard to negotiate. And I felt that that was very fair. So that is correct.
Thank you, Dr. Murillo. I'm going to our student trustee, Raja Osera.
Thank you. I have three questions. Those are the main issues, the sports team, so SBCC student athletes and the PE department have. I had the opportunity to talk directly to the sports team, so to our students athletes with ISG President Diallo. And the first question is it going to collide or interfere with athletic clubs' schedules?
The games will be on Saturday night. The schedules we will work around. I met with the track and field coach, with the football coach in person, and also the head of PE was on a telephone call and outlined how we need to work together. Like any rental agreement, all of the teams that rent your facility have to work around what the football team does, what the track team does, what PE does. And again, as a former PE teacher, I fully understand the complexity of scheduling when you've got a facility and everybody wants to use it. So what we would do is any team does, particularly all of the teams around the country now that play at this level, work with, most of them are using community college stadiums, or in the future, many are getting purpose-built soccer stadiums in their facilities, in their areas. But you'd work around the schedules. I mean, there's 24 hours in a day, and you just work around where football needs it, where track and field needs it, and where athletics and PE need it. I don't see much PE going on Saturday night games. There are typically, I believe, going to be 7 p.m.-ish kickoffs to take into account a national TV audience. But obviously, we'd work around the schedules that the school and the athletics and the PE department would provide us.
Oh, okay. Thank you. And also, are you going to remove or cover the football emblem that is on the field?
The conversation we had with the football coach is that the Vaquero logo would stay. We need to work on the soccer lines because they're black right now and thin and you just simply can't see them. But the conversation we had is that we would leave them there. Not ideal, but that's what the football coach wants. And so we would work around that. We just need to, the real work we need to do is how we find a color combination that works on the soccer lines. If you know, you've got the big red end zones, which I know you're familiar with. We've got to figure out where the soccer goals go in there, and then figure out for the TV viewing audience how they can clearly see the lines. And that's a figuring out a particular color that would pop on TV, as well as the players. You're an athlete, so you've got to be able to figure out if you're inbounds, out of bounds, if the ball's gone out. So you know how all that works, and we'll work through that.
Okay, I just want to make it clear to the board that students athletes were totally against it when we talked to them. But today, some of their questions are probably gonna get answered, so I'll let them know.
Thank you.
Trustee Parker?
Yep, just a brief thank you to everybody that's been working so hard on this. And Mr. Moore, I was desperately sorry to be out of town for the Moxie event. But congratulations to how well things are going in terms of your launch. And I hope things go just as smoothly with the contract. And I have a lot of hope that we'll be able to work it out and get it on an agenda pretty quick here. So thanks again.
Thank you.
Bestie Everett.
Yes, thank you, Vice President Abood. Thank you so much for coming, Mr. Moore. I also was out of town and could not make the event. And I am a little concerned about a couple of things. First, I want to say I share a lot of Trustee Gallardo's enthusiasm, as well as yours, about the potential and the possibility. But I also share the concerns that Trustees Croninger and
did we lose board member Everett?
Lost a connection.
Oh, I'm sorry.
You're back. You're back. Okay, you're great. Back.
I was just going to say, but I do also have some concerns because when you say we've lost a year and I'm hearing about our meeting in April, what year that, you know, time has gone that we haven't been in on those earlier discussions? So that's one concern about the speed with which things are moving. Having listened to the student trustee, I also share some of those concerns. So I think having a closed session where some of these concerns as well as excitement can be addressed, then, you know, I really would like to, you know, find out how we can just move forward. But a couple of concerns, but also I have an open mind.
Sure. And thank you for that. The year in question is that there are certain approvals and milestones whenever you're about to embark upon and it being an expansion franchise within a league. The United States Soccer Federation weighs in. We had to get the playing surface FIFA certified. So we paid for that. It is FIFA certified because it's an artificial playing surface. It's not natural grass. As I say, the floodlights, we've got to prove that we can get to 100 candle power, otherwise we cannot play. So all of the things that we're trying to do, there is a classic work stream and milestones that have got to be met. And we started to miss them because of the length of time it was taking. And so I'm a merry band of one and some volunteers from the soccer community doing this. I have a full-time job and doing this in my spare time. It's a question of we decided, and certainly talking with Vice President Maas as well as Mr. Miller, look, we got a lot of work to do here. We're not going to make March of 2023 kickoff. We need to sign players, sign head coaches. We need to be ready to draft players that are graduating, hopefully from UCSB and give them a professional career. And it was all coming too soon. So we kind of swallowed hard and said, look, we'll push it off. We'll go ready for 2024. We need to bring investment in here as well. But that is why we made that decision that we cannot meet the milestones and the roadmap for 2023.
Thank you. And I do understand that that year out is something that evidently and had to occur before approaching us. But I'm saying that shouldn't factor into our discussions because we haven't had a year to consider this. That was my point. But thank you.
Okay. All right.
Do any other trustees have? Oh, Trustee Hasland.
I won't be long. Most everything that I would want to say has already been said. And the discussion leads me to the conclusion that we need to be careful in how we present things, because obviously we're speaking in different languages. This brings about the misunderstanding of who's really in charge. Is it the president's council or is it the board of trustees? I can understand if I received such a note from the president's cabinet, I might make the same conclusion. So we just need to be a little more careful. I continue to be optimistic, but it's very clear that there are some very specific things that we'll need to be clear about before anything like a contract can be signed.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Haslin. That's what I wanted to say too. Trustee Gallardo.
Thank you, Jonathan. Kindred, I'm wondering, I heard Marsha, Robert, and then Anna agree. What would be the reason for a closed session? I don't understand what we would be talking about behind closed doors that we can't publicly talk about. Do you see a reason why something like this would be discussed behind closed doors and away from the public?
I would need to check with Craig on whether this could go to closed session or not. Traditionally, property, the negotiations for purchasing property, et cetera, have gone to closed session. A lease like this, rental, I'm not sure. So I would actually defer to Craig on whether it can actually go to closed session.
Yeah, because I wouldn't want to give the impression that there's someone trying to kill this project behind closed doors. Mr. Morgan, thank you. And enterprise works a lot different than education, especially education in California. Things work really slow and they're politically just complicated, unfortunately. I see your heart and I think your heart's in the right place. And for my board member colleagues, we're not flush with cash. Someone is trying to help us and trying to help students and the community. For me, this is a no-brainer. It's a win-win. I think that the questions, Mr. Moore's a tough man, enterprise business. I'm sure he's standing there strong, but I do think the questions are not consistent with our values and the way we treat community members or guests. So I do want to apologize on behalf of my colleagues. While they are passionate to serve their constituents and community, I do think that the questioning was a little out of line and quite honestly inappropriate for a partner that is saying, I want to help you and I want to help your college get in better shape to serve all kids, and it will greatly benefit the athletic department. I would love to see your name on our new PE building because we also don't have money for that new building. So Kindred, I would like us to sort of circle back on that because I don't want something to go to closed session behind closed doors for someone to talk about something that they can't publicly say. I want us to leave here feeling like we have a partner. This is a good thing. And everyone's going to benefit. And Santa Barbara is lucky to have this opportunity come to us. So thank you.
Thank you for making that point, Trustee Gallardo. Trustee Corninger.
I just wanted to mention that it is a quite typical provision of the Brown Act for the board to have a closed session to discuss negotiations with a real estate matter. That has its own subdivision. It's normal. There is nothing untoward about it, as Trustee Gallardo seems to think. So I think it would be helpful to the board to have that discussion.
Thank you. Do we have any other trustees who want to say something? I'll just say I also regrettably could not be there. I was on vacation that day. It's I guess early July is a time for public people in the public sphere to take off. But I wish I had been there, and I'm looking forward to having this partnership with you and in full support of this project and coming. So thank you for coming here today, Mr. Moore, and looking forward to getting this wrapped up in the near future and having my, you know, being there in March 2024 to watch the first game at our stadium. So
thank you, Mr. Abood, and thank you, board members. I know these things are challenging and difficult, but I will always tell you, as my dad said, nothing worth achieving is easy. And these are things that this community wants. I'll echo the words of the mayor. We absolutely desperately need to feed the kids of this soccer town and give them the facilities they want. And as I said, and you probably read in the press, I want kids waking up in the morning and want to play for the Santa Barbara Sky. I don't want to play him for LA. I don't want to play him for San Jose. I want to play him for Santa Barbara. So I'll leave it at that, and I'll let you get on with your board meeting and look forward to hearing from you in the not too distant future, hopefully.
Thank you for being here. We'll talk soon.
Thank you. I'll exit. Thank you.
Okay. Next up on the agenda, we're going to announcement of closed session and adjournment. So we're going to closed session for three items today. One is superintendent president evaluation. Two is conference with labor negotiator for faculty association, and three is conference with labor negotiator for the California School Employees Association. And do we have any public comment for closed session?
I have not received any, Jonathan.
Sounds good. Anybody in the attendees? Give you 2 seconds to raise your hand. All right, then we'll go into closed session now and we'll be back at 5 p.m. on the dot.
I placed the closed session link in the chat as usual. You also have it in your emails. And I already have the meeting opened.
we got some waiting on our trustees to return. Okay, let's see. Okay, we're still, we need Peter back. Peter, another second to get on. So back into the open session, and there is nothing to report from closed session from the board. And next up is public comment. And do we have anybody here for general public comment today? So not something already on the agenda. Please raise your hand. Okay, so it doesn't look like we have any general public comment. So we'll move on to communicate. We don't have any minutes to approve today, and we'll move on to communications. And we'll start off with a report from the Academic Senate.
I don't believe we have anybody. Melanie is on vacation, so it doesn't look like she sent anybody to this.
Sounds good. And then do we have our AS president, Turner Diallo, here?
Yes, he's in the audience, so we can let him in.
Wait for him to move over. Right. Turner, it's all you.
Hello, everyone.
Hello.
Okay, so thank you for meeting Board of Trustees. And today I'm going to give a very short report about what the ASG have been up to since we were inaugurated about a month ago. So right now we are mostly on the preparation process to start off the fall semester. And we have our first summer ASG meeting tomorrow, where we'll do most of our planning so that we can get a quick head start into the upcoming semester. And on our agenda for tomorrow, we have items to do with the application process for all of the positions in the ASG. Because as of right now, we only have the 6 elected officers, which is the president, the 2 vice presidents, the student trustee, and the student advocate, and the vice president for finance. But we need about 10 more officers to fill up all of the commissioner positions to have a full board. So tomorrow we'll be discussing about that. And also we are going to plan about Welcome Week activities, which will start early August, to have activities to welcome students back to campus and help them with informational resources about everything they can get or experience on campus. So far, so good. That's the only report we have for now. Thank you.
Thank you, AS President Diallo. Does anyone have any questions for him? Well, welcome back to the meetings. You're still here. Glad to have you. We'll move on next to CSCA report by Liz Ashenklaas.
Good afternoon, members of the board. I'm going to be brief today. We've been in negotiations with the district. We hope to eventually wrap up our contract that's already a year expired, but we're working on it. We're also been in discussions. Dr. Murillo's had a lot of input on discussions about how to proceed with the new heightened COVID. So we've been talking about how to proceed with that. So I thank her for being very inclusive in her discussions. And the districts also have arranged anti-bias training for staff. So we're starting to get some of that training. And they're also working on something called trauma-informed racial healing training, which they're working on trying to develop something like that for us. So that's my report. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody have any questions? Nope. All right. We'll get to our Faculty Association report, Dr. Cornelia Alsheimer.
Good afternoon, honorable members of the Board of Trustees, President Aboud, Dr. Murillo. Could I please have my slides? I think I sent them earlier. That would be amazing. Thank you so much. And thank you for having the Faculty Association on your agenda again today. I would like to start my report with another heartfelt welcome to Vice Presidents Paloma Arnold and Maria Vera Gomez. And with this welcome, I want to combine a confession that at last month's board meeting, I totally missed to thank departing EVP Kathleen Scott for her work. Dr. Scott had become such a stable presence on this campus over the last 12 months that it had just slipped my mind that, in fact, she would leave us at the end of June. So here it is, me catching up with my farewell wishes. Next slide, please. Moving on to today's agenda, and given that you just came out of closed session, you surely heard from Dr. Shanahan that the district and the FA teams have been very busy negotiating. There's always some immediate need to reach an agreement on specific topics. This month, we signed a side letter to support our nursing department with a more appropriate release time structure for their leadership team. We also were proactive and codified our plans for faculty TLU loads for next summer. You probably remember that in 2023, our summer will be structured differently than we have it this year and the years before. Instead of 2 6-week sessions, we will have 1 10-week session. But within this one session, there will be a lot of flexibility to schedule classes over 4 weeks, 5 weeks, 6, 8, or 10 weeks. This will be especially useful for challenging courses that are not as easy for students to master in a short 6-week period. So to make a long story short, the FA and the district have created a set of parameters which are designed to guide the upcoming summer scheduling efforts with respect to faculty TLUs. Finally, COVID and its impact on teaching and other faculty work is still taking its chunk of time in our negotiations. Coming to another important summer activity, which is our upcoming Faculty Association Executive Board Retreat on August 1st, in person, but outdoors. The PE department has generously offered us their tent for that day. Among other items, we will meet with the Gensler Strategic Planning Team. We will talk about the main areas that our FA work will focus on through the upcoming year. And we are looking forward to the discussion with some members of your group about budget and fiscal stability. So far, we already have Trustee Croninger as a confirmed participant, which is really great. So just saying, there's definitely room for one or two more of your group if you want to join us. In closing, I would like to give you a glimpse of what else our FA board is doing during summer break. Next slide, please. As you can see, we are working hard to support our college community in various roles and various ways. I did not quite cover every letter in the alphabet, but we see that it is a substantial number. And please allow me to highlight a few of these items. Let's start with AB 1705. Last month, faculty member Barbara Bell and myself remotely attended an important hearing of the Senate Higher Ed Committee and testified on behalf of many SPCC faculty in opposition to AB 1705, as it would take choices away from our student unless it is amended. In support of our important and exceptional nursing department, we brainstormed with the administration on how we can work together as an institution and with our area hospitals to attract more nurses to join our faculty ranks. Finally, I would like to draw your attention to the support we provide on a unique issue for our part-time faculty. As you are aware, almost half of our classes are taught by part-timers. As at every college in the system, every single one of our part-time faculty is out of a job on the last day of finals week. Applying for unemployment benefits between terms is one of the hard-earned rights our part-time colleagues have, and the FA provides assistance in filing applications, appeals, and going to hearings. If you are interested in any other of the topics on my long list, please feel free to ask. Otherwise, I will speak to them at future board meetings. And thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you. Does anybody have any questions? No? All right. Then we'll move on next to report from board subcommittees. Policy committee, I'll just say, is meeting next week. So no report from us, but anybody else? No committees met, I assume. Right. That sounds good. And then we'll end with our report from our interim superintendent, Dr. Maria.
Just a couple of things. I just want to say welcome to our two new vice presidents. I know that our last board meeting, Paloma Arnold and Dr. Maria Villa Gomez. Very happy to have you here. And with that, I'm not going to say anything else more. I sent out a things to know today, so you can read it there.
Thank you. Yes, welcome to our excellent new vice presidents. Thank you for being here in the meeting. Let's move on to our consent agenda. Does anybody have anything? The consent agenda is going to be Section 9, Human Resources, Section 10, Academic Affairs. There's nothing in Section 11 and Section 12. Anybody have anything, Poole? Can we get a motion to approve the consent agenda?
So moved.
We have a motion. Do we have a second? Trustee Kerninger, is that a request to pull or is that a second? You're muted.
Trying to check against which ones you were listing. So were you listing all of 12?
Yeah, it's 9 through 12.
Okay, so I just wanted to make a couple of comments on 12.2.
Okay, so let's pull that one, 12.2, and we'll approve it separately. So we'll make a trustee Everett is your motion now for 9 through 12 minus 12.2.
Yes, so moved.
Thank you. Do you have a second?
Second.
Thank you. And we do have public comment. So before we go to a vote, let's hear public comment. And Barbara, so if we could please pull her into the panelists. Okay, Barbara.
Can you hear me? Yes. Can you hear me? Yes. Thank you. Thank you, Board of Trustees, for this opportunity to give feedback on the ADL contract 12.4. I am speaking today as a Jewish member of the community, asking you to drop the ADL contract as anti-bias trainers at City College. There are three reasons for this request. First, I'm a Jew who is aware of widespread anti-Semitism and am willing to speak out against it wherever it arises. However, the Anti-Defamation League considers any criticism of the Israeli occupation of the Palestinian people as anti-Semitic. The ADL persists in conflating the criticism of Israel with anti-Semitism. They do this to blunt any criticism of Israel, and it is often successful because many people, especially non-Jews, do not want to be tarred with the stain of anti-Semitism. For Jews, the charge is often that they are self-hating Jews. Nevertheless, many Americans, Jewish and otherwise, consider criticism of the government of Israel as a moral responsibility to fight for human rights of the Palestinian people. Criticism of a government's actions is not the same as hating that country or the people in it. The ADL considers criticism of Israel as the same as hating Jews. This is false and harmful to all those who wish to fight for social justice in the world. The second reason is informed by my experience working with Palestinian students and professors around racial justice issues. Many Palestinian students, teachers, and members of the community I've worked with are unwilling to come forward to criticize the Anti-Defamation League for fear of losing their jobs or endangering their families. This may be one reason why criticism of the ADL is rare. And the third reason is that as many progressive groups learn about the ADL's current harmful practices, they are rethinking their relationship to the organization. Even though the ADL is integrated into the community work on a range of issues, it has a history and ongoing a pattern of attacking social justice movements led by communities of color, queer people, immigrants, Muslims, Arabs, and other marginalized groups, while aligning itself with police, right-wing leaders, and perpetrators of state violence. More disturbing, it has often conducted these attacks under the banner of civil rights. This largely unpublicized history comes increasingly to light as activists work to make sense of the ADL's role in condemning the movement for Black lives. Palestinian rights organizing and Congressional Representative Ilhan Omar, among others. Over 100 social justice organizations nationwide have condemned and signed an open letter about the ADL's undermining struggles for justice. Before you sign the contract with the ADL, it would benefit you all to read the information I will have sent to you and have an open discussion about the issues raised there. Additionally, articles published by The Guardian and Jewish Currents reveal a draft memo addressed to Anti-Defamation League CEO Jonathan Greenblatt, written during the height of the Black-led uprisings in June 2020, sparked by the police murder of George Floyd, entitled "Law Enforcement Trainings in Israel" and authored by senior staff at the ADL. The document details how the ADL, one of the main facilitators of police exchanges between the US and Israel, was forced to acknowledge that its exchange program helped militarize US police and harm communities of color. As this information becomes common knowledge, you will find yourselves defending an organization that is desperately trying to cover up its own biases against people of color. Please do not sign the contract with the ADL. Thank you for your consideration. And my name is Barbara Parmet. Thank you for
making comment. We are in the motion to approve the consent agenda. Are we ready to take a vote? All right, let's do a roll call vote, please. Oh, Trustee Garrido.
Thank you, Jonathan. Kindred, there's the claim, the liability claim that's on there. And I know there's no attachment, probably because this was brought to us maybe in a closed session. Was that the case? It's item 8.9.6. This is approval of liability claim. And it just has one line. It just says to approve.
I have three attachments on that one for me.
Really?
Yeah, maybe try reloading it. You mean 9.6, right? Sorry.
That I believe is correct. Yes, approval of liability claim, 9.6.
Yeah, there's three attachments on here.
Okay. All right, but they're actually in the item.
Yeah, okay, that's interesting. If there, you know, usually has the little notebook page on the right-hand side.
Yeah.
And I clicked on it. It just says claimant Rami Alberts, agency claim agent Santa Barbara Community College, and then the government code. But
yeah,
I take your word if you saw it and it's there. It's just maybe not loading on an iOS device.
It's not loading on mine either.
Yeah, I think the board docs on iOS is not very good. I try to use it too on my phone, but I have it here on my computer up and it is up here. We can maybe share screen the attachments if people really want to see them, or?
Are you on a computer, Peter, or are you in an iOS device?
No, I'm on a computer.
Well, Martha says she doesn't see any attachments either.
That's very weird. Okay. Well, we could, is it possible to continue this one to the next meeting, Kindred, so in case people weren't able to view the materials?
Can you screen share them like Jonathan suggested, and when we can wrap it up? What do you think?
Yeah, Oren.
Oh, Luke says he also doesn't have them. That's interesting. Oh.
Well, if you may I speak? They're on the agenda.
Yeah.
The attachments are under executive files.
We don't have those files.
That's why I can see it. Yeah, because.
They're under.
I see. It has a different icon, like a lock or a key. So
now I see what happened. All right.
Same thing with the register of warrants, Kindred. 12.7 is not visible, or the visibility study.
What? Oh, gosh, you're kidding me. Okay, hold on. Let's take a look at this.
There is no attachment for that.
I apologize, Palmita and Kinder. If I was not out of town all last week, I would have looked closer.
Register of warrants. The information is on the agenda. There's no attachment for that.
There's no attachment on that one.
So yeah, just the information there, the county treasury warrant range, the amount, 20 million, 680.
I think what happened is probably, Palmita, you put it in the executive section where only the board members would usually have access to that. So Michael, is there a problem if we bring this back next month so everybody has the information? Because I think somebody's making, I don't know why it was put in the executive
session. I mean, technically, no, it's just that the person whose expenses we have caused will be waiting that much longer for reimbursement from us. I can potentially share. It's a very small, it's $2,700. And one of our employees was in a car accident. And so we're paying for the person they hit. It's fairly small. If we could do it tonight, it would be, I think, better for the individual that, you know, we hurt. Damaged, whose, you know, property we damaged, but there's no, it's not mandatory.
Okay. If our board members are okay with it, I think that makes sense to just do the share screen with you, Michael, but are people cool with that?
Yes.
Okay. So yeah, Michael, please go ahead to share your screen.
All right. So let me pull up the estimate first. Make sure I've got the right file up. Okay. So basically, it's an estimate. We have an official estimate for this work, right? It's the rear bumper, some headlights, some lights, and some quarter panel. It's not a lot, and it comes to about $2,700. So you can see the totality of it. It was a minor car accident while they were working for us. I have a, let's see here. I can, if I can pull up the other one, which is the actual report, if you want to see that too.
Yes, please pull up the report.
Sure.
So Michael, this was a City College vehicle that was in a collision with another vehicle.
It was one of our individual, it was one of our employees, right? Let me see, I can pull it up here.
On a City College vehicle or in their personal vehicle?
I'm not sure which vehicle they were in yet. Hold on just a moment.
It's in a City College vehicle.
Here we go. All right. So yes, it was a school vehicle. This individual was rear-ended by our employee in a school vehicle. They were preparing to merge when our person smashed into their left rear light signal and damaged the bumper. So no injuries, just property damage. No one saw the actual accident, but we did validate, you know, and we have photographs of the damage.
Okay, sounds good. Thank you. Thank you, Michael. So just going back, we're still in the original motion to approve the consent agenda, except 12.2. So I think I would like to do that now so we can get to 12.2. So let's call the roll, please.
Okay. Student trustee Raja Ocera?
Yes.
Trustee Gallardo?
Yes.
Trustee Abood?
Yes.
Trustee Croninger?
Yes, though I comment that I appreciate the public comment that we had on the subject of the ADL.
Trustee Parker? Oh. Trustee Haslund?
Aye.
Trustee Everett?
Aye. And I also agree with Marcia.
Trustee Miller?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Let's go to 12.2. Trustee Croninger, do you have your questions or comments on that?
Yeah, my comments are pretty much the same comments I always make on some of these retainer contracts or legal contracts. In this case, the Atkinson contract has a provision where they can bill us while they are traveling, and they can also bill another client at the same time. And for me, that's double billing, and I do not like that. So I prefer asking them to either bill us or bill the other client, but not both, one or the other. And also they talk about advancing costs, which could include copying and faxes and telephone. This is often a separate profit center for law firms, which again, we have asked our other law firms to wrap it into the hourly rate. I do appreciate the costs for expert witnesses or filing fees. That's not the same thing at all, but when people say costs, and frankly, this the way they've done it here makes it complicated. If you're going to charge 25 cents a page or 50 cents a page for copying something, that is not your cost. And then we have some silly argument about that. So that's another thing I would suggest. They just drop that from their advancing costs statement.
Thank you.
That's it.
Yeah, I will just... I'll support what you said, because at the Isla Vista Community Services District, we have a law firm doing work for us that work with many other special districts and local governments in Santa Barbara and San Luis Obispo counties. And when they do travel, they split the cost of the travel but equally between everybody instead of double billing, like you mentioned. And what they said is explicitly that they will double bill in here. They're not retreating from that. So it is done by other legal firms working with public agencies to split the billing between different clients while traveling. So Trustee Miller.
Yeah, I completely support Marcia's comments and concerns.
Thank you. All right, well, then we can do a motion to approve that to negotiate with that change, or we could wait. Does anyone want to make a motion to that effect of approving this with that provision?
I would think it would be cleaner if we went back to them and tried to negotiate this before we took a vote.
Okay. Dr. Maria, do we need to get this approved today? Is there a...
No, I'll bring it back to you.
Okay.
And actually, I'm going to ask staff to make sure that we don't bring any more legal contracts forward that have anything regarding the cost of printing and that particular issue, so we don't have this issue come up again. So we'll just start making sure before it gets to the board that these things are taken care of.
I think that's good.
Appreciate that. Trustee Gallardo.
Thank you, Johnny. Kindred, I was just going to comment that the response we've received from your chair, from people sitting in your chair, your Zoom screen in the past, this is for at least this firm, is that's their standard of providing services. So is this something that you're thinking you're going to just look for a different firm?
No, we'll go back and basically note to them that this is, I usually just go back to the firm and let them know that it's an unacceptable cost for us. And if they want to do business with us, then fine. If they don't, then we won't do it. So there, what you're noting is a reasonable issue. And I think that people are paying more and more attention to these types of contracts. So we will do business with firms that work with us.
So you'll just find someone else, basically.
Well, I think they'll work with us. I mean, yeah. I've worked with AALRR for years, and they've been pretty reasonable firm overall.
Yeah.
Thank you. And Trustee Croninger, anything else?
I would just add that, as Jonathan mentioned, this is pretty standard when you have a lawyer working for a public agency. And I've had experience with multiple public agency lawyer agreements that do not have these two provisions that I'm talking about, and just finished negotiating one with a law firm for a nonprofit, same terms, so.
Okay, so no motion or action on 12.2 today, and we can move on to section 13 of the agenda if no one else has anything to say. Thank you, everybody.
Did we have a motion to pass on the consent agenda?
We did.
Okay.
Yes. Next up is 13.1, new classifications, and the recommended action is to approve the new manager and educational administrator job descriptions. So is there a presentation on this one, or we can do a motion?
Or asking you to approve, and if the board has any questions, Vice President Shanahan and I can answer them.
Excellent. Well, do we have a motion?
I so move.
Motion from Trustee Haslund, a second.
Second.
Trustee Everett, and any discussion? Trustee Garrett.
You know, the previous ones, Kendra, you brought to us with job descriptions. Is this one that just didn't show up on our end, the job description, besides the, I know the description of kind of high level what the position title it does, but there's usually a full job description attached.
Okay. You know, it looks like we have another situation with the locked documents, because I can see them here, but okay. They have the same icon for 12.
Yeah, for they actually, they are in the administrative front. Okay, I think we've got a problem overall. All right.
I can see them too. I can see them on my computer. I saw them. I read them.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, they come up with me with that same icon for the other one, but if most people can see them, maybe we can do a quick share screen to, if Tracy Gerardo has anything.
Well, they're short, but
yeah.
I'm gonna ask real quick, why, I'm just curious as to why these were put in the administrative content area. Can HR advise on that?
I do not know. This is not something we do typically, and we've done it before, so I don't know how it, I don't know.
Okay, because that should, they are in the administrative content, and they should be in the public content, so that's where they're showing up. So, okay, we'll keep an eye out for that issue. This is the first time I've seen these kind of come up this way, so.
Yeah, I've never seen this before, and it's possible Diana being relatively new put him in the wrong place, but she's done agendas before without this problem, so I'm not quite sure what happened.
Okay, all right, so can we do the screen share real quick, because the coordinator job is in the agenda, and we are looking to move this forward.
Thank you.
Oh, that's much broader.
Here we go. So basically, by the way, these are both grant-funded positions. And this is working in RAES's first year and beyond. It's a student student empowerment program.
Okay, thank you.
All right, and then we pull up the other one.
I assume we'll attach them to the agenda afterward.
They are attached to the agenda. They just went into the wrong place again. Yeah,
but for the public to see.
Yeah, we'll have to fix it and see why this is happening.
Yeah. And Palmita, can you make that change?
Yes.
Mike, please.
I will. Thank you.
And then this is a director of employer engagement, right? This is actually working with the South Coast Regional Consortium, job developers. This is a pretty important position, really, to sort of find employment for our students.
Okay. Yeah, let's just scroll through it slowly so people have a chance to see it on YouTube or Zoom. And if anybody has public comment, raise your hand now to get ready. We'll get moved to that once we have a motion. Okay. All right. Thank you, Michael. Mm-hmm. And do we have any discussion or comments from our board or a motion?
So I'm just wondering now. So thank you, Michael, for noting that one was grant funded.
They're both grant funded.
No, they're both grant funded. So yeah. Is in the job description, is something written that this is, so let me back up. So in the past, we've had grant funded positions. And then and Marcia can remember these conversations, when the grant runs out, that employee then continues on the payroll, but then the revenue no longer is coming in, right? Is there a process by which this grant funded position will sunset? Or usually the goal is that we would scale these programs up and you know, they would impact the institution as a whole, et cetera. In the past, we just haven't tightened up that process. So we have a lot of these little mini grant positions that then get grandfathered in and we're left with all sorts of things. Is that cleaned up before we go into this hiring with this grant? Oh, you're smiling. Like, okay.
So the job description, for instance, for the Raices coordinator actually mm-hmm. says it's contingent upon continued funding of the Title V HSI grant. Okay. I don't have the other one in front of me, but employer engagement basically says the same thing. It is contingent upon the workforce development funding from the regional employer engagement grant. So the specs are set up as contingent upon continuing funding. Our behavior, on the other hand, is something that we have to hold strong to, right? So what you're saying is, even though we may have had the ability to release people when the grant funding went away, we haven't always consistently done that. And that, I'm not sure about that because I haven't been here, you know, long enough, but that really is up to us when the grant funding goes away, right? Whether we release them or find something else. So, you have approved are classifications contingent on grant funding.
Okay. So then maybe for a retreat, and I think that's something that we're interested in, how once the money is invested, how we either scale right. this so it doesn't become a short term, the grant ends, and then folks, so that folks are being placed where the biggest impact is for whatever the needs of that seed money was. And I think that that's something to sort of prioritize, if not this coming year. It's been a problem in the past. We just don't know where these positions end up.
Thank you, Trustee Gallardo. And next, Trustee Croninger.
I was just curious, the subject is marked as new classifications, but it seems to me that classified manager and educational administrator are classifications we already have. Is there something else going on?
Yeah, well, no, the new classification is director employer engagement and the coordinator program raises. That's what's new.
But aren't they just new job descriptions within existing classifications?
There are new classifications. They are new job descriptions.
I just didn't think those were the same thing, but all right. If that's your lingo.
Yeah, well, we call everything class specs, right? Essentially class specifications. But basically they're job descriptions. It's just in our system, we don't have individual ones. We just have by the job title. But these are two new job titles.
And descriptions.
And descriptions, yes.
Okay.
Do we have a motion?
We did. We also had a second.
We had one for this one. Okay. I'll trust you. Yeah, let's call the roll.
Student Trustee Raja Osera?
Yes.
Trustee Croninger?
Yes.
Trustee Miller?
Yes.
Trustee Haslund?
Aye.
Trustee Abood?
Yes.
Trustee Gallardo?
Yes.
Trustee Everett?
Aye.
And then Trustee Parker is absent.
Thank you.
Motion passes.
Okay, we'll move on to 13.2, which is the 2024 to 2028 5-year capital outlay. And it's recommended that we approve it today. And we'll pass it over to Dr. Maria to give us any more context.
Okay, thank you. We discussed this last month and we had quite a bit of input and concerns around some of the projects we have listed. Our approach this year is just to have the buildings and the projects that we need to do something about on the 5-year capital outlay plan, knowing that we will probably reprioritize after we finish doing our seismic assessments. And we have more information on our facilities master planning, which we should have next year. So I've asked that you approve it. We don't all agree on the priorities in it, but again, it will change. And all we're trying to do is make sure that the state of California basically knows that our facilities are in need of some severe funding. So with that, I'll turn it over to Vice President Moss.
Thank you, Dr. Murillo. I did want to spend a moment going over some of the information here. As Dr. Murillo said, that we're bringing the report, the 5-year capital outlay plan, and the final project proposal for the physical science building replacement in the same final format as last month. There have been no changes to the reports. However, I want to take a moment because of the questions that came up last month. We put together some additional information in a PDF that's attached there that's called FPP Physical Science Slide Deck. And if IT wouldn't mind bringing that up, I promise not to bore you with 30 minutes of going through these, but I do wanna spend just a moment reviewing them because of the previous board meeting where there were some questions about the physical science building project and why we're requesting it as a final project proposal at this time as a part of the 5-year capital outlay plan. So the next slide, please. Oh, I also want to point out that our facilities planning consultant, Eric Middlestead, who's instrumental in writing these reports, happened to be available. So he is here in case we have any really specific questions on the FPP. He can answer those for us. Next slide, please. So here's just a summary of the project itself. It's a like-for-like building replacement. So we're requesting to replace the current physical science building, which we kind of all feel like it's one building, but it's actually two. There's the lecture hall and then the other larger building with the classrooms and labs. So the square footage will remain the same for the new building, although the new building would be in a different location on campus. That is really helpful in terms of not needing to find temporary housing while we do the construction of the project. So the programs can continue to operate in their current location while we build the new building. And then we demolish the old building after the new building is complete. Next slide, please. This is just some information about the academic side of the building and the proposal. Next slide. So as a part of the final project proposal, we completed a seismic analysis of the current building. And that analysis provided some very important information to us. It informed us that the building is at a risk level of 5, a performance level of 5, and there's only 7 levels on the seismic performance level scale. So being at level 5 does make the building unacceptable in terms of its seismic performance. And this is an important aspect of why we're interested in replacing the building. And then there's also just a note that we have a very rough estimate that to bring the building into a current structural code would be about $6 million. That's not including additional costs around the site that would need to be modified as well. Things like ramps and walkways that would need to be modified. Next slide, please. So this is just a refresher. We've brought this information to the facilities subcommittee and to the board as well, but it's an important point about DSA. So DSA is the Division of State Architects, and they have this IREB4 that was initially released in 2021. And it determines that when we look at buildings that need, that we're looking at either renovating or replacing, that when we hit the cost of 50% or more to replace, sorry, to renovate the item, when it's going to cost 50% or more just to build a brand new building, DSA requires us to do a mandatory full seismic rehabilitation for the building. So this is a really important threshold for us, that when we're looking at the cost of modernizing or remodeling buildings, if we get above that 50%, and architects and our planning consultants will say, really, we should be looking at 40% because there's often cost overruns after you've gotten into the project. So our architects would say at 40% of the replacement value, it's better just to replace a building versus renovate it. So this is important for this particular building, and you'll see that in a couple more slides when we have the cost listed out. Next slide, please. I think it's on the next slide. Yes, right here. So as a part of the FPP itself, we're required by the Chancellor's Office to list out these three alternatives of how to replace the building or other options in case we don't replace the building, what the costs are for these three different alternatives. And the Chancellor's Office will only fund the least cost option. And for us, the removing and replacing the building is the least cost. You can see alternative two is one of the scenarios they require us to pencil out. And then alternative three, which is really the more, you know, realistic one, is would we just renovate the existing building? And the renovation estimate is coming in just a hair over the replacing the building. However, we wouldn't be able to receive funding for that because it's a higher cost. And next slide, please. I just wanted to throw this in here so folks could have an idea of where the new proposed physical science building would go. This is just a little kind of screenshot of the campus. That building in the middle there is our student services building. And below the student services building is where the current physical science building is. And in this image, it's now just lawn and a nice new ramp. So this is showing where the new building would be to the right of student services. And then below student services, that old building would be removed. All right, next slide. So just a high level project timeline for everyone. So a reminder that in this 5-year capital outlay plan, the final project proposal that we're submitting, we are submitting it for the state budget funding year of 24-25. This is not for next year. We have to submit it in advance for a future funding year of 24-25. So that's why these dates begin after or in that year, 2024, with the final construction being complete out in August of 2028. All right, next slide. And this is the last slide here. We wanted to do a quick overview of what the estimated costs are for this project for the board members who are a part of the facilities subcommittee meetings. This is a snippet from the various bond and or facility needs lists that we've shown many times that has listed all those projects. So hopefully you're familiar with some of those headers there in the title. So on the far left, you have the state cost and the local cost. Those are the dollar amounts you're gonna see in the FPP. And those are the unescalated for inflation costs. So then you go to the right and we have some escalation assumptions built in, increasing those numbers. So as you recall, this is a project that would require local funding from the district. The state does not provide 100% funding for this type of project. So the local estimated cost for with inflation is that $7.7 million. And we have additional estimates. We want to be as mapping out as much as we know we would have to pay for this project. It's more than just that local cost. It's also a couple $1 million for furniture and equipment and almost $3 million potentially as an estimate for the fact that we have the Santa Barbara factor where the bids come in a bit higher than other areas. So we just have an estimate of approximately $12 million that the district would need to fund that the state would not be funding for the project. However, the state would be funding about $23.7 million after including inflation. And that is what I wanted to recap.
Great. Thank you, Lindsay, and thank you all for preparing this for us. Do we have any questions, comments, or are we able to make a motion? Trustee Croninger.
Well, I have some comments, but I don't know if you want to do the motion first or second. It's up to you.
Yeah, it would be cool to get the motion in first. Does anyone want to make that?
Sure, I'll move approval.
I'll second.
Thank you. All right, Trustee Croninger, you're back.
Okay, so for me, it's I'm not concerned about the basic list of projects for the five-year construction plan. The only thing that concerns me is the FFP at this moment for the physical science, because it locks us in to a particular approach. And Kindred and I have talked about this a lot. This is no surprise here. And for me, it's kind of like a Groundhog Day. We got into Campus Center and we didn't have the money to pay our local share. We got into the PE building and we are presently without the money to pay our local share. This would be a third project that we would be getting into for another $12.6 million that we don't have the money to pay our local share. And what also concerns me is that it's a one-for-one trade-off to what we have to something that's basically the same and updated and better and new and shiny. But it doesn't address the campus in a more holistic way. And what I would like to see is all of our basic sciences in one big new building working together. I would like to cover all of our labs. I'm a big fan of this problem that our labs are old and outdated and need to be addressed. And this project, this FFP, covers less than 20% of our labs. Most of them are on the EBS building. Some of them are in the admin building. And this is just a tiny portion of them. And none of those other labs appear in our list at all. So what I think is a far better concept here is to wait and pull this all together in a new science building. And that, I think, is a tremendous project for a bond for 2024. I think our community would be very excited about that kind of a project where all the labs need to be updated and all the science programs get the chance to work together and interact and learn in one up-to-date modern building. At the same time, I recognize this seismic problem, and I have no problem with some sort of temporary solution that takes down the lecture hall and even the labs, have a temporary situation for the labs before we can get to a new building. Obviously that's not the plan here. If it's felt that we should just keep the labs as they are in a temporary way, I'm okay with that too. But I have no problem with the idea that we take down the large lecture hall because we have space in other large lecture halls. If we just scheduled things in the afternoon instead of just in the morning, or maybe even Fridays. Either way, we have room because we are half the size of the college almost that we were when this campus was built out as it currently is. So I prefer that big picture. I prefer addressing all of our labs, and I prefer updating everything together as one package that we can put before the voters as a really exciting project. That's my pitch, along with the fact that yet again, we don't have the money, and I don't want to be stuck with telling folks we do have the money and then having to say, sorry, we don't.
Thank you, Trustee Croninger. Trustee Hasland.
Well, I'm wondering if it wouldn't be appropriate for Dr. Murillo to respond to that.
Yes. Please do, Dr. Murillo.
Thank you. Marcia and I have talked about this until we both recognize that we don't agree on it. And that's okay. I mean, we have some very good discussions about it. So my response to that is that this building has seismic problems and that it needs to go. And we need to replace, start moving the college forward on replacing some of these buildings. You've got the physical education building and this building. They both have level 5 seismic issues and are outdated. And we need to get the college back in line for additional funding. I feel very strongly that the college has been at a standstill on dealing with its facilities for the last 10 years, and it's continuing to pay for that standstill. And I feel pretty confident that the physical science and the physical education buildings are both buildings that you're going to need in the future. Now, I would really agree with Trustee Croninger on the fact that I do not think we're going to need the same square footage. And we would like the next year to work on that and understand what our programs will look like. And we also agree that a great big, great, nice science building would be lovely and ideal. And that's probably another 5 to 6 years out while your students are continuing and your faculty are teaching in outdated labs. So, you have an opportunity to deal with this. I have no, what do you call it? The only interest I have is moving the college forward with your facilities. And it's been dragging its feet for a very long time. And so I recommended to move forward on this particular project. I believe you can go out for a bond. I've been told we can't run a capital campaign in Santa Barbara. It won't go anywhere, but I think we should try to raise money that way. And we've got to keep trying to do something and position this college for a bond in 2024. Your facilities are falling apart, and I don't mind saying that publicly.
Thank you, Dr. Maria. Trustee Haslam, back to you.
Thank you. Kindred, are you saying that the additional square footage required for the additional labs would necessarily delay the process? And is that what you're worried about?
No, I'm not worried about, it wouldn't be additional square footage. I think we're going to be downsizing eventually. This is a basic replacement of a new modern facility for the physical sciences area. And while I understand that there's a sense it's like for like, but it is also an updated facility. So my concern is that you have not moved anything forward and really done any major construction on your facilities in a long, long time, and they continue to get worse and worse. So while we're working on a seismic retrofit, looking at the whole college, and we're working on a new facilities master plan, we need to start dealing with some of these facilities.
Well, I mean, I find myself agreeing with both you and Marcia. And I'm trying to find a way of pulling them together so that we can advance on both tracks. And I'm hoping that somebody can help us with that. The specific question I wanted to raise when I looked at the budget numbers had to do with the demolition of the existing structure. Is that, Lindsay, is that included in the cost estimates?
Yes, it is.
Okay. It is not inexpensive.
It's included in the final project proposal to the state, and the state would fund a portion of it.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
And then Trustee Gallardo.
Thank you, Jonathan. Thank you, Mr. Middleston, for sticking with us. I noticed your Zoom square there. It's been about 5 years now. Marcia, I envision what you're saying. I think in an ideal world, that would be wonderful. But I also know that chemists within science, there's different disciplines, and chemistry has different needs than life science and botany and nursing, for that matter. I mean, I envision our entire nursing health fields over by Cottage at the Schott Center. I'm okay with what's presented here. Kindred, I think one of your colleagues at the conference said a culture kill strategy, right? And so we have a culture opportunity here at Santa Barbara City College. And so for me to see Lindsay's labor, and Lindsay, you're very talented in this area. And, you know, 2018 was all about facilities. Mr. Middleston spent hours with the board in 2018. So when I look at these PDFs coming up here in the agenda, which these did attach, thank you. For me, it's excitement to move forward and think of some facilities that are going to help students. That physical science building, I thought was old when I was a student there. And so it definitely needs updating. But at the same time, it's sad to see that the culture kill strategy, because president after president, I don't think much has changed since 2018. And like, here we are in the same place, still talking about the same thing. And is that a function of local government? Is that a function of public education in California? I don't know. But really, the culture at San Francisco City College has to change. The facilities are outdated, unsafe, and we do have to move forward. I do think that at this period in time, moving forward with the plan that Mr. Middleston and Lindsay have put together with seeking state funding is the way to go. It's still taxpayer money. It's up for grabs. And if we can apply for it, why not? It'll be less local share that our local folks here have to pay for. So I understand that this is not a hierarchy of what's better, what's needed, sort of. This is where you've done the math, you looked at the different variables to submit something that we think can get funded. And for that, I thank both you and Eric for doing that, and I'm in support of moving this forward. And then Kindred, I mean, you're here with us for a few more months, you know, through winter, and I think you would agree, because I heard it from you, culture kills strategy, and we've got a lot of strategy reviving that we can do to keep it in the positive so that we can get a win-win here for everyone. And then if definitely with Ms. Villagomez on board, really looking deeply into what are the teaching and learning needs that we're gonna be looking at in the near future, with looking at how we're designing our program, our instruction, meeting the needs of learners. We are gonna be getting a new type of student with the pandemic. Our seniors, the last time they were in school full-time, they were, you know, like sophomores, freshmen. So you're looking at a population of young adults that have really not had their high school experience. So we talked about really meeting the needs of supporting with math and English. We're really gonna see some opportunities in the way of programming and services and the physical structure of where we're housing these students. So with all that in mind, I think that this is, it's the best to move forward. So thank you, Lindsay and Eric, for sticking with us here.
Thank you, Trustee Gallardo. Trustee Everett.
Thank you very much, Vice President Abood. Mr. Middlestead, thank you so much. And I wanted to just echo what Trustee Gallardo said about the different needs of the sciences, so that all-purpose science building is just not really feasible. And I think the longer we wait, the cost just becomes cost prohibitive, and then we don't get anywhere. So I really would like to hear from Mr. Middlestead anything that he would like to add, but I do think the project sounds like it's sound and that we should move forward with it. And I appreciate the work that's gone into it, and I do think that we need to act. So, I mean, it's not ideal, granted, but I do think we need to move. So I was wondering if Mr. Middlestead had something to add to that. We haven't heard from him.
Sure, and thank you for inviting me. Listening to all the trustees, I think what I can contribute is, if the trustees were to decide to go with a single building or even a bigger building, we just wouldn't qualify. You know, there's policies in place at the chancellor's office. Our job, working with Vice President Moss, is to strategize how to get the most money from the state to offset your local costs. the chancellor's office, we even had to ask them if we could include these two buildings because they don't fund more than one building at a time. But because these had the same name, they were technically connected and have the same function, they allowed us to put two buildings in to replace it with one. If we were to try to put three buildings in or four, they just wouldn't allow it. They have a one building policy. So that's critical. The second piece would be, we, as a campus, you know, you have the same space you had, you have half the students. In the state's eyes, you're considered overbuilt. So that's why strategically this project, even though it's a new building, is classified as a modernization category. We don't qualify for growth. So if we were to grow this building by one gross square foot, it would be considered a growth project and we would get rejected. So everything that you're seeing today and the way you're discussing it, and Trustee Gallardo, I appreciate the compliments that you attended well when we were there a while back and you kind of an A to Z. It's all about strategy. That's what we do. We look for the best strategy. So as we looked early on at other buildings, other possibilities, they just didn't own up to the level of this one. So it did seem like your best opportunity for funding. But if at the end of the day, if you decide that you want a bigger singular building, it's not going to get any state money. It's just not. So you're just going to have to fund all that on your own with taxpayer money. That's basically what I can contribute.
Thank you. Trustee Croninger.
Just a couple things. As a biology major myself, I do think that a single building working together is a synergistic situation. And I know among our conversations, Kindred has referenced some really interesting, spectacular science buildings that she would wish we could visit and see the results of that at other colleges. So I don't think it's infeasible. I think it is true that the state, I'm not arguing that the state would fund it. What I'm arguing is it is frustrating that so many of the state's rules really cut against the kind of strategic planning and the synergy and the learning environment that you might like to create in a community college. I mean, I just find many of their rules overly, I guess I could call them anachronistic. Many of them stem from a time when all of the colleges were growing and still seem to apply those sorts of thinking. And they also allow very little imagination when they say, you know, you have X, you must replicate X and that kind of thing. I mean, it just doesn't allow us the flexibility to build a campus that is truly responsive to students, and that's disappointing. So I would say it's something you ask for your community to support. It's not something that you expect to get state money for, but it's a better thing. Sorry.
Thank you, Trustee Croninger. Do you have any other discussions or questions today? Are you ready to vote? Okay, let's call a roll. Paulmina, please.
Okay. Student Trustee Raja Osera?
Yes.
Trustee Miller?
Yes.
Trustee Haslund?
Aye.
Trustee Gallardo?
Yes.
Trustee Abood?
Yes.
Trustee Croninger?
No, but only as to the FFP.
And Trustee Everett?
Aye.
Okay, thank you. All right, so it is 6:10. We have 6 agenda items left, not all of them will take that long. What's the board's preference? Do you want to take a break till 6:30? Do you want to just get this done in the next 20 to 30 to 40 minutes? I think we could get this done before 7.
Get this done?
Okay, I agree. Let's go to item 14.2. Exciting for me personally, the student housing needs feasibility study funding update. Dr. Maria, please go ahead.
Okay, so I'm going to turn this over again to Vice President Moss to just let you know what is going on with the feasibility study, and we'll make it short and to the point.
Thank you, Dr. Murillo. Yes, Dr. Murillo asked that we just bring an update. There's not a ton of things going on, but there is a little bit of an update here on this one. First of all, originally we requested $250,000 for a grant to do a feasibility study for student housing. And we have been informed that we have received $150,000. We have not received the full $250,000. So $100,000 was removed from our original request and is not being funded to us. However, the next step, next issue is that currently the Chancellor's Office doesn't have a process for how to allocate the funds to us. So we're not able to start just yet. We're in a little bit of a holding pattern. As soon as we get authorization to proceed from the Chancellor's Office, we will move forward with the feasibility study portion of the project. The loss of the $100,000 was contributed to a portion of the request we had that was on moving forward with designing the housing and potentially constructing it. So it really was kind of a second step. With the $150,000 that we will receive, that's plenty of money to have us do the feasibility study itself. So that works out okay. We'll be able to do the feasibility study, get the results of the study, and then decide if we want to go forward for the next portion, which is doing a grant for the actual construction itself of a student housing project. And that we're assuming, we don't have the exact information yet, but we're assuming that the deadline for that is going to be not until October 2023. So we're on track.
Excellent. Thank you for the context and information. Any trustees? Trustee Everett.
First of all, I do have to kind of let you know that I may drop out again and get kicked off because I'm having internet instability issues, but I'm really happy to see this on the agenda and that this could likely go forward. And also, I just wanted to comment that I was reading in the Chronicle of Higher Education, and they were talking about how just across the nation, there is such a demand for housing, and that with rents being so high, campus housing is at a premium and they're full. And so, and we already know what's going on with UCSB and those issues, but I think if we could move the ball forward on getting some student housing, and I think that would go far towards getting our enrollment numbers back on track, because people would be excited about, you know, having some place to live in Santa Barbara and at City College. So I just wanted to add that little caveat about the housing situation across the universities and colleges here as well as across the nation, but here in California. So I'd like for us to move forward.
Thank you, Trustee Everett. Trustee Gallardo.
Thank you, Jonathan. Lindsay, when you get to the stage of looking at the scope of what that feasibility study is going to look like, will that come to a subcommittee, or are you not there yet in thinking of the future?
You know what? I left Mr. Middlestead here because he's a real expert on this too, and he helped. I understand that we are contracting with a agency that what they do is feasibility studies and analysis for community colleges and colleges. So I think they are very well versed in knowing what the scope of the feasibility should be. I don't know if that helps. I don't know if there's anything else that we could add for you on that.
Okay, that's good. So then, having Eric still here, if I were to read a report of feasibility study, I would hope that at least somewhere in there, it captures what the need is for housing for that, for like here in our community. So for example, Santa Barbara Unified School District, I'll have a student kind of my roster, and it would have said housing and secure, would have been classified as homeless under California. But you meet with the family, and so they're not homeless. They have a home, they're living with tia or grandma or someone. However, that family unit themselves doesn't have a home by themselves. So because we are a local community college here in Santa Barbara, and not just the west side, the east side, but all throughout town, I would be interested to know what percentage of our students would benefit from family housing. where you have a multi-generational household, and that is where the student is unable to execute all of his responsibilities in the household because of the multiple competing adults or whatever it is, right? And so if there is a way for us as a community college to have information, what would benefit our families? Because our local students, I presume, relying on the multiple income strategy that many of our Latino families rely on to help with housing and rent, would benefit from the entire unit living together. Oftentimes they rely on each other for childcare, and housing overheads. So in addition to our students that come here from out of town that need a bed to sleep in and a roommate in an apartment, I'm really interested in seeing what is the housing need for a family unit, a first generation college student coming to Santa Barbara City College that's currently living in a multi-generational household who was classified as homeless in their K-12 schooling, but we know it's a matter of him or her family unit getting a residence of their own. Does that make sense, Mr. Middleton?
Yes.
Yeah.
And that will be done. The group, as Vice President Moss mentioned, this is all they do, feasibility studies, and they're doing more. I'm working with them on more than 20 right now. Mm-hmm. And they start with student surveys. As they put a team together from the college, the administrative team, sometimes it's president's cabinet, and they go through a whole process. It takes about 4 months. So they get feedback from the students. Would they be interested? That's the feasibility side. Mm-hmm. And then they also look at the funding side and to see if it's financially possible for like a public-private partnership, a P3. So they're looking at all aspects, and sometimes it pencils out and sometimes it doesn't. But they start with the needs part coming from the students. As you have your first kickoff meeting, if you're interested in getting more about family units, we would just make sure that they're surveying that because their job is just to get the needs down, right? Mm-hmm. But there's a second component here, the actual state funding grant. And these are 100% state funded, so just so you know it. But it's called the Affordable Housing Act, and there's affordability clause. And like any state money, there's lots of strings attached to it. And those strings, now you could build, I have one district who built family units into their grant last year, and it got funded, or it's on the funded list right now. But you would choose, based on your feasibility study and knowing the culture of what you're looking for, the layout of those rooms. However, I want to say this. Part of the criteria that they're writing in now, and they didn't even tell us about it last year, they just graded them this way without us even knowing the criteria, was the total cost per bed. And the more space you have for less beds, the more money it costs, right? It's like $1 per square foot. So if someone has 100 beds in their grant proposal and it costs $50 million, that's $500,000 a bed. If someone else has 200 beds and they're making just small double dorm units and it costs $50,000, theirs is half the price. They're going to get more points. So that's one of the things we need to be concerned about when we get into the grant. While it's great to have everyone as an apartment style housing, if that's what you feel is best for students and student learning, that may not be strategic for the criteria under the state funding process. So some folks are saying, we're going to get the dorms we want with local money or a P3 if it's available, and not go with the state money because, again, of those rigid rules. Another one is there's a maximum you can charge for these rooms. There's a funding formula. It's basically the poverty level of half the area median, and you can only charge that maximum. I don't know Santa Barbara off the top of my head, but I do remember in the Central Valley last year, that was $619 for a dorm room. Many districts say we can't make that pencil out and they don't want to subsidize housing. So as you get into the actual big housing grant yourself, and as Vice President Moss mentioned, that would be next cycle. This cycle, this year, we would be doing the feasibility, and we'd be looking at, if the board approves and everything comes together, the big housing grant for October of 2023, we would want to make sure we knew all of the commitments under the grant. Like you have to allow the students to stay there 12 months out of the year that want to stay there because it's affordable housing, right? Basically, like you had mentioned, Trustee Gallardo, some of these students are homeless or they're living in their cars. They may have an address, but they're living in their car. So it makes no sense to kick them out to be homeless again in the summer. Well, that onus is on the district. right? Someone's got to manage that, or, you know, and there's costs associated. So while it looks good at the trustee level, hey, there's a bunch of money, let's go get it. There's always the devil in the details with the strings of the grant, but we're going to start out with that feasibility study first. And then that will help inform your decision, the number of beds based on the demand that the students say, and any other parameter. And I know there's a sweet spot for whether there's public-private partnerships or not. A sweet spot meaning the number of beds, because they have to make a profit on it, right? So lots of work still to do, but the first step is this feasibility study, and we are funded for it. We are just not approved. As Vice President Moss mentioned, the new bill for housing also transferred responsibility from the Department of Finance to the Chancellor's office. The Chancellor's office didn't get any staff, and they're just trying to figure out the policies right now, which is why, while it was in the governor's budget to be authorized, they haven't given us authorization to spend the money yet. They don't know how to give us that authorization. So they're looking into it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Trustee Croninger.
It sounds like to me that we would really benefit as a board from maybe a study session on the scope of the feasibility study. I see that as very important. I think that Veronica has brought up a particular piece of information that we would like to have. There's a lot of other things that are unique about Santa Barbara, perhaps, that might not be apparent to a group that does, 20 or 30 of these for all different community colleges, and issues that we as trustees might want to have factored into feasibility. For example, the responsibilities of the district for this housing, what will we have to do? What are the cost impacts? I don't know, but I'm suggesting a study session comment period right before we actually finalize and do that feasibility.
Thank you. I definitely agree with that. It'd be good to see a scope of work in writing of what exactly this feasibility study will do, because this is our big shot to do this, and we should do it comprehensively and as right as possible, and more information about who we're going to work with. So I support that idea of a study session in the near future. And a couple of years ago, in 2018, we also had appointed some trustees to participate in a campus committee that was overseeing. We had actually originally voted to do a feasibility study in 2018. We never did it, but we did appoint two trustees to participate on a campus committee. I think something like that would be good, just to have more eyes on the process as it's going and more people involved. Just, we can catch a lot. Our staff and faculty and students who live in the community can also catch things as well. So, and I just want to say one last comment. I've been pushing our district to do this for 8 years now, which I can't believe it's been 8 years. I was 21 years old. I'm really glad that I'm turning 30 in a month, but I'm really glad that we're finally actually doing this, because it's been a need since 2014. It's been a need longer than that. And we, Ventura County Community College, they're building now. They got the grant to build. So we're behind them. They got the promise before us too. So I'd like to see us get this done and apply for that 2023 grant. So looking forward to the study session on this. Anything else? Marcia, do you have more comments?
No, except that we have the best promise program.
We do, yes, ours is the best. So we come in a little later, but we do it the best. Let's move on then, if no one else has any comments, to item 14.3, the 2022-2023 COVID-19 Emergency Conditions Allowance Update. It's just a report. Kendra, do we have anything?
Actually, we can go over it real quickly. Vice President Moss can quickly go over the emergency conditions allowance. We were just trying to make sure that the board is aware of this. And we're in the process of trying to make a decision of whether to move forward. Right now, I can tell you our recommendation would be to apply for it, but we haven't made a final recommendation. So Lindsay, would you like to go over the item?
Yeah, I'll just go over it real quickly if I can. So the emergency conditions allowance, I'm gonna try and refresh our memory of what this is. So in the last few years during COVID, we have been funded based on pre-COVID FCS levels for our apportionment allocation. And during COVID so far, the state has funded us on ECA just automatically. There was no process. We didn't have to request anything or provide any documentation. It was just a part of our annual funding without us having to take any action. During the last 6-7 months, as we've been waiting for the final budget information to come from the state to us for 2022-23, in the January budget, governor's budget, they were not going to be doing ECA again in 2022-23. We were potentially going to lose that funding. And then same with May. It was like, okay, we're not going to have it come through. But then in the June budget, the ECA was back. This is very good news for all of the districts. You know, we still have our enrollment is significantly lower than pre-COVID. So being able to utilize the ECA into 2022-23 is very beneficial to us, specifically for this upcoming year and future years, because you may recall that our student-centered funding formula for one of the primary allocation calculations is a three-year funding average for 3 years worth of FTS. So we'll be able to continue having our pre-COVID FTS levels from 1920 as our 22-23 FTS in the event that 22-23 is lower than those numbers. So it helps us for many funding years. Now, the new piece of what's happening here is that they're requesting that we apply for it. And not only do we apply, but we also meet some conditions. And you can see these in the attachments. The memo is one attachment. The application itself is another attachment. They're nearly identical. So the team has gone through what these items are to determine, can we do these things? Some of them are things we're already doing, such as providing our audit, providing MIS data. That's very standard and not an issue for us. Some of the others around the CVC online training, we are already working on those items. However, we're not complete with it. So it does create some additional workload for us to get through that. And there's another one where we need to submit I don't have the document up in front of me, but a enrollment report, a recovery enrollment report through our strategic enrollment management committee. We have a lot of that information, so we'll be able to create that. The deadline for this is September 1st to apply for ECA. Most district CBOs I've talked to are all doing it, and others have a similar dynamic as us where there are some new things we'll have to do here, but it's not, none of it is a huge lift that'll be too difficult. So that's this one.
Thank you, Lindsay. All right, so then we have no action to take. Does anyone have any questions? Trustee Croninger?
Yeah, I'm wondering, is there some criteria for being turned down? Is there a limit on the number of people who get accepted?
Not that I'm aware of, no.
Not that we're aware of at all. And I think they're just trying to get us to do some things that that comply with getting into the CDC OEI.
Okay.
Trustee Gallardo.
Thank you, Jonathan. Thank you, Lindsay. I continue to be vigilant, Kindred, that we're operating with money that we really don't have. These are just like extra because the state's good effort to try to help colleges. So when I see the help coming, it's so that you can help yourself. So they're saying, here you are, we're gonna help you out because you don't have the money. And so we're gonna cover you for a little bit. We haven't made the adjustments as an institution. And so not just Sacramento, but now a lot of the policy think tanks across the country are saying when this money runs out, it's right about the time the recession is supposed to hit. Now, no one has a way to see into the future, but usually folks respond strategically to economic forecast. And here we have a very clear economic forecast now for multiple industries telling us. Now, private industry is making the adjustments they need to. Local school boards have to work through the different bargaining groups and all sorts of things. But I do think that this is a major alarm that we really need to get serious about. We don't have money. We have money that is coming to us so that we can get through and adjust things, but we're not adjusting anything. And so that's problematic. And I'd like to see this sooner rather than later because the mission of the college will not be able to move forward.
Thank you. Does anybody have any other comments or questions on this topic? Trustee Croninger?
Well, I just mentioned that we have a work group that Dr. Murillo has put together. You and I are on it, Jonathan, and that's exactly what speaks to what Trustee Gallardo is saying. So I'm not sure. We've had that on the agenda a couple times, and I think we have every hope of moving forward and making adjustments.
Yes, thank you. I am excited to get started with that. And I saw Dr. Maria sent out an email to get appointments to it. So we'll get started soon. Let's move on then to 14.4, which is the 21-22 annual apportionment period summary, the CCFS 320P3.
Yes, we wanted to make sure the board was updated on our most recent numbers. And I believe, I'm not sure, Vice President, Gomez is going to report, or Dr. Reese?
I'm going to take this one if it's okay. Good afternoon. So this is going to be the first time that we presented this report in this manner. So I'd like to take a little bit of time to familiarize you all with it. And just a reminder on how we kind of do our reporting for apportionment. We report it 4 times a year. So first we report it in early January, then we report it in late April, then we report it in July. That is the one we're looking at now. And then we have a recalibration one in November. So we'll try to get these reports to you close to when we report those. So when we're looking at the report, up at the top section, you have all of our credit FTS. Currently, the way that our summers land, you end up with a leading summer being the first part of our apportionment period, then followed by our trailing summer with our two kind of primary terms in the middle, summer sandwich, if you will. That's going to be kind of our simplest, or well, credit FTS are relatively simple to compute when we're talking about what type of apportions we're getting. So you see all that up here in the top area. You'll have our 21-22 annual. That's going to be in this first column here. And then you'll have our recal here from our previous year and the change, as well as the change in a percentage. So just kind of giving you a quick summary over there of what's going on in the credit FTS. FTS is full-time equivalent students. Then what you'll see kind of as you get down into non-credit, the apportionment methods in there are a little bit more complicated. We have two flavors of FTS over in non-credit. Enhanced and non-enhanced. Enhanced gets funded at pretty much a credit rate, while non-enhanced is funded at a slightly lower rate. That's why you see this kind of added bit of detail in the non-credit area. Overall, you'll see that with our total FTS on the credit side, we are currently down 3.5% from the recal in 2021. Now, we are still being funded on our 2019-2020 numbers, but we do need to keep a close eye on this. When we are looking at our non-credit total FTS, we'll see that we are up 4.8%. And then when we're looking at our total FTS, you'll see that we are down overall 2.7% from last year. And that is all I have on this one. If anyone has any questions, comments, or concerns.
Thank you. Trustee Gallardo.
Thank you, Jonathan. Reese, what types of classes are the enhanced non-credit?
Enhanced non-credit ones are ones that lead to a program or a certificate. So they tend to be things, well, there's actually a whole lot of them, but anything that leads towards a certificate is considered an enhanced FTS and program.
Okay, so that's a big concern, that dropped in that 55%, which is not surprising to me. I think that's been my communication, Kindred, all year long, that I know that these students are not there because they've told me they're not there. Reese, do you have the headcount?
I can provide the headcounts.
Maybe later.
Which specific headcounts are you interested in?
I mean, it'd be good to see all of them because FTS makes up a full-time equivalent student, which could be 2 to 3. Can make one depending on what the unit load is. Is that something that we can get later, or?
Yeah, we'd be happy to provide headcount reports. Just let us know kind of the specifics on that and we can work to provide that.
So your report was perfect, just in that column at the headcount.
Then it is gonna get a bit weird doing headcount.
Because of the delta and the way it factors, so all the way across,
And then also you're going to have people that are in enhanced and non-enhanced, that are in credit and non-credit. So you're going to end up with a lot of duplication in that headcount.
Messy. Okay. So then just whatever we can get, that would be a clean, the cleanest to get us an idea of the headcount.
Just like an overall credit and non-credit headcount?
Yeah.
And
similar to what you've provided here with the FTS. It's good. I think the categories, the way you broke it up, is a good way to see it. But I'm just curious to see what the headcount is. The 10-point-ish is definitely concerning in the decline of students. And as we look to look at programs, and there's programs that we're not going to be able to downsize. The reality is they're needed. We're going to have to put the students through, because whether they're a certificate that the economy needs or whatnot. And so we know that those programs are going to cost us more, even if we're serving less students in that program. So I just, in my projection and what I want to see, is I want to get an accurate, close to an accurate picture as where we are right now, given that we are spending money that has been given to us to sort of refine things. And so I want to be able to project to see where we're heading.
Yeah.
And if your report looks different, reason, that's okay too, because I see what you're saying. You're not going to be able to match it. I understand that.
Yeah, so we might want to actually work out a different report that is more specific to headcount and isn't going to be conflated with our apportionment.
Okay, thank you.
Trustee Groninger.
Yeah, while we're talking about what data we like to see, what I have been interested in both for this section and for the next agenda item, which is where we are now, or close to where we are now, is the in-district numbers instead of just a generic California resident number. So what? How much of that is in-district? How much of that is out of district?
With the current tools that we use to do our apportionment reporting, we do not receive a student level apportionment. It's at the section level. So it makes it very difficult to break out which of our districts, you know, which student provides how many FTS. So at this time, we can't break that out. We have looked into kind of what we need to do to modify the software so that we do have that information. It is unfortunately a sizable chunk of change to kind of hire a consultant to work in Banner to pull that information out of the system.
Well, is that what we did when we had our retreat a while back and we had that disaggregated data? Because we did disaggregate data for in-district and out-of-district as well as a lot of other categories.
Correct. When we're in the headcounts, we can disaggregate as freely as we'd like. It's really when we get into the FTS that those are really computed at a section level rather than a student level. So it's very difficult to then break that out into saying how many FTS were attributed to a student who was from Carpinteria.
Okay, well, headcount is at least one indication of which way we're headed, and that's what I'm interested in.
Okay. Yeah. And we know that for the next one as well. We just wanted to kind of, anyways, we'll address that when that one comes up in the second here.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Let's move on then. If there's no one else, we can go to 14.5, the fall 22 enrollment update as of July 8th.
Now, BC.
Sure. I'll take that one. Is that okay, Dr. Villagomez?
Be my guest. Sure.
All right. Thank you much. All right. So this is going to be the first time that we have been sharing an enrollment report for this time. Usually we have done enrollment reports for the start of term and for census. We would like to get in the practice of doing this at open enrollment as well as the start of term and census. In future reports, we will definitely break out the CA resident by our in-district and such. We just were on a back foot a little bit with this one when we were kind of thinking, okay, we would like to provide some open enrollment information. This is what we were able to do at the time. Future times, we will provide you the further breakout of the CA resident that you're used to seeing. And you'll see that when we do the start of term report, as well as the census report. But as we are looking at the open enrollment, we have our total headcount and total cumulative units. Total cumulative units is used as a proxy to get us to FTS. It is not a one-to-one, but it gives us a kind of soft idea of how we're doing. Currently, when we were in open enrollment, we saw that we were up by 2.1% on headcount over our previous fall. as well as up 1.1 on our total cumulative units. This is promising. We're going to keep an eye on this as we go through the enrollment cycle. And now that we are in open enrollment and see how that plays out, I believe you all see some of the enrollment reports, so you may have more up-to-date information on that. When we are looking at CA residents, California residents, we see pretty much flat, a slight increase in headcount, very slight increase in cumulative units. Non-residents, we see increases both in headcount and unit. And then below, you see the detail of that non-resident. Just a note for anyone who is particularly quick with their math, you'll notice that 296 and 320 does not equal 622. We are looking into why these two do not add up to this total number. If there's any questions on that, we would love to field them.
Any questions? Trustee Gallardo?
Yeah, thank you, Jonathan. Do we know what the increase was in that 50% international student? Is it because they were able to stay in their home country and take online? Or did we just grow the Santa Barbara program in-house by 50% and manage to decline every other area?
So when we're looking at the international increase of 53%?
Mm-hmm.
So that program has grown. Part of that comes from when we are working with small numbers and in our international students priorly, we were at pretty small numbers. It is it is easier to see a large percentage increase. Unlike when you're working with, you know, a couple thousand numbers, it's very hard to see that 50% increase. So part of that is just the way we do our percentages. But yeah, we have seen that kind of increase of almost a doubling of our international students coming back to us.
They were physically here on campus this year?
Many of them, yes. And
but we managed to decline significantly in every other area, locally and non-cred. Okay, I want us to keep an eye on that because visually, I think that's problematic that we increase a really important population of student that contributes to the overall campus. And it's just amazing to have students here interfacing with students because we're not a very diverse community in Santa Barbara. But then I look at all of the other numbers on the far right here. And so maybe enrollment strategy, is that on the agenda for the board retreat, or is that something that's not gonna get tackled this year? Is that gonna wait till next year, Kendra, till a new president comes in, or?
We actually are finalizing the strategic enrollment management plan.
Okay.
And that will be coming forward. I don't know if it'll be on the retreat agenda. I'll be working with the board president and the vice president on that agenda.
Okay. Awesome, thank you.
And I just wanted to note, what I'm looking at here shows a minuscule decrease in units for CA residents, but an increase in headcount for everything except out-of-state students within the United States. So we lost out-of-state within the US, but gained out-of-state from overseas. So I didn't see a decrease anywhere here, personally. Trustee Haslam. You're muted.
There, sorry about that. I thought Z's explanation of why it is easier to see a substantial percentage increase when the numbers are low. I mean, we took a major hit in terms of international students in part because of COVID, in part because the national administration was making things more difficult for international students, any number of reasons, but the whole number. So, I mean, doubling the number, if we have 10 students to 20, that represents 100% increase, and that looks terrible on if you're concerned about that sort of thing. But I am not surprised. I'm rather happy that we are seeing a 53% increase.
Yes, we did used to be, you know, at 1,100 or more here, yeah. And that's a significant budget impact too. And we saw that during 1920 and 2122. So it's part of our strategy from over a year ago. And we did fund additional funding for marketing and staff to help with international students. So it's part of the plan. Trustee Croninger.
So I looked at today's enrollment report just for a general update. And the total headcount is down 3.25% the total cumulative units were down 2.5%. The resident head, California resident headcount down 4.5%. The units for California residents down 3.8%. The non-resident headcount 8.4%, which is considerably lower than the 12.7. Again, I think you're seeing the effect that Z is talking about in terms of small numbers, but the small numbers also, there's an impact in the sense, and what I tend to look at is what percentage of our teaching time, our FTEs, are resident versus non-resident. And those numbers have tended to be not unlike the past, because even though we have fewer international and out-of-state students, we also have fewer in-state students. And so those percentages tell me what's going on there. So that's what I look at.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Any other comments, questions, concerns? It's good news overall. We're not bleeding people anymore. So I took an optimistic view. Section 14.6, monthly budget update. I don't know if there's a lot to report on here, but it's for the end of last fiscal year.
Is there anything you want to note of importance, Vice President Moss?
Just one item. Thank you, Dr. Muriel. One item I want to make sure everyone is aware of is that as you look at this report, even though it is dated the June 30th year-end report, we have not closed the books yet. It's very early for us to be doing a year-end report. These are not the final numbers for the unrestricted general fund or for the unrestricted general fund that's the COVID mitigation fund. So please do expect to see an updated report from us with the year-end final numbers.
Okay, thank you. And 6.8 million as our, you know, our surplus. Is that in the ballpark of where it'll land, or is there a big variance expected there?
Not expecting a big variance from that, but I am expecting a variance from that as the books aren't closed yet. Yes.
Thank you. Trustee Croninger.
The one thing I particularly wanted to note about the report is, and tell me, Lindsay, if I'm reading it wrong, but on page 5 of 11, we're talking about our reserve balances, and we have a reserve, designated reserve, in other words, our policy reserve of 20,338,000-ish. And undesignated reserves of 10.1 million. But if you subtract out the federal funding that we have gotten, the HRF funding, which I read to be total of 13.6 million, we would be below our policy reserves by $3.5 million. So that federal money is really important to where we sit now, and it's not going to continue, obviously. And so the work group that we are looking forward to working on really has work to do here. It looks, I think, more robust than what we will see going forward. And so we need to keep that in mind.
I can respond just briefly.
Go ahead.
Yes, Trustee Croninger, I see what you're doing with the math there. There's definitely some logic behind that, that the HRF funding that we've received has absolutely helped support us during the COVID pandemic. Not only has it helped fund the COVID specific expenditures, but it's also helped bolster programs that are separate from our funding mechanisms through the state and provided us with lost revenue backfill funding. That's absolutely going to continue to be an issue for us in the future. But it is kind of nuanced because a lot of those expenses covered from the HRF funding are specific only to COVID. So it's just a little bit tricky to say how much of that $13 million would be ongoing expenses for us.
Thank you.
I'm just saying it's money we wouldn't have had, whatever we spent it on or didn't spend it on. We wouldn't have had it but for the federal money.
Yeah.
We are very lucky and grateful the government, the federal government stepped in to help us in that emergency. Let's move on then, if there's nothing else, to 15.1, which is resolution one, which allows us to keep meeting over Zoom like we are right now. So do we have a motion to approve this?
So moved.
Thank you. Do we have a second?
Second.
And roll call, Palomino, please. Oh, do we have any public comment? No. Palomino, please roll call.
No, we don't. Sorry, I'm having some internet.
Oh, no problem.
No public comment.
All right, let's call the roll then.
Student trustee Raja Osera?
Yes.
Trustee Gallardo?
Yes.
Trustee Abood?
Yes.
Trustee Croninger?
Yes.
Trustee Parker?
Absent.
Oh, I'm sorry. Trustee Haslin?
Aye.
Trustee Everett?
Aye.
And Trustee Miller?
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you, Palomino. All right, well, we promised we'd do it before 7. We have 8 minutes left. Reports from board members. Anyone have anything to report since our last meeting? Trustee Gardner.
Yes.
Thank you, Jonathan. Yeah, we have our location secured. Thank you, Palomino, for helping us. And so we reached out to Elise Simmons, a wonderful Santa Barbara High principal. So our forum, SBC Forum, will be at the high school, which is a city landmark. So I think that everybody will know where to go. My only comment would be that when we did do this at the Schott Center with Helen, we did have more than 30 people. And so I anticipate that we might have more than 30 people. So that's just something Kindred, as folks in our office, are working with Elisa's folks. And she did report to us, we have a facility use agreement already with them, a memorandum of understanding, so we don't have to pay for a fee and we don't have to pay for custodial. So that's a nice reciprocal relationship we have. And so it should be a great event at the high school. So hope to see you guys all there.
Excellent. Glad we're doing. Trustee Haslin.
Just a comment about what's happening at the Garvin Theater. The play is called Something Rotten. Fortunately, they did not add in Denmark. I like that part, but I thought it was fantastic. Katie Laris just did a beautiful, beautiful job. And if you haven't seen it and you want to have a hilarious night out, go see it.
Thank you.
I heard the exact same thing from some neighbors who went.
Then what could go wrong? Go see it, but you have to hurry. I think it ends this week. Yeah. Maybe then tonight. I'm not sure.
No, I have tickets for tomorrow night. I think it goes on Friday night and Saturday night, and then it's gone.
Okay. Anybody else have something to report? I'll just say my report was I got to attend the high school adult high school graduation and conferred the degrees, and it was an amazing. It's my first time going. It was an amazing experience. Getting to see everybody there. It was excellent. So I will be going again next year, but I hope to see everybody else there as you can. And also went to Kathy Scott's farewell reception, and you know, really, really grateful for everything she did. And a year ago, we were in very high need for help and she came in and helped us. So it was great to see her send her off. Next up is items for future board consideration. We have 3 on here: masks for speakers, discussion on a fiscally healthy college. I think we're doing that in our work group, and resolution 1 revisions. So that's we've kind of already talked about that as well at the last meeting. So anybody else have any other items for the next future meetings?
I'm thinking we mentioned a couple in the meeting today, one of which being the feasibility study down the road, the discussion of that. And I've now forgotten what the other was. I think there were at least 2.
That's, we'll maybe have to go watch the video. I'll go back and look at my
notes. I will pick them up in the minutes too.
Right. Okay. And I just have to take the floor for one more second, just on my board report. I did want to note one thing, which is I was watching the housing element update meetings at the local city councils and the county board. And I just kept hearing from different members, city council members, planning commissioners, you know, myth about our size of our college and just discussion about SBCC being massively huge and 25,000 people going here. You know, this is myth from 2009 at this point. And so, and this is part of my fault, I'm the legislative liaison, but maybe it's something we should do again, is like some education one-on-one with our local elected officials about who we are now and what we're doing now and things going on with the college, because it just seemed like people were operating off of information from 13 years ago about SBCC, and it's very discouraging to watch because they're making decisions about housing element and housing needs in the area and going off of totally wrong issues. So that would just be one more thing. I'll volunteer myself to help with that since it's my board role, but
I'll help.
Kindred, to that point, Lori would print out the small little quick facts, college facts, they fit in your wallet. So those were, I know it's like an old school thing to print something up, but they were really handy. It's basically your 2-minute elevator speech of what the enrollment looked like in the past, now, and going forward. And it was a trifold. Yeah. If that's still something marketing can produce, I think they're helpful.
I have the old one on my desk. So we'll look at that. And also I was planning on going to the city council meetings to introduce myself and talk about our strategic planning and what we're doing. So I will also carry the message.
Thank you. Yes, and the trifles were excellent when we had them. All right, well then let's move on. We don't need to, we're gonna go back to item 17, which is reconvene to closed session. I think we don't need to reconvene to closed session. And we will then go to 18, which is adjourn our meeting. So let's do a quick motion to do that and we'll get on with it.
Anyone want to? I move that we adjourn.
Trustee Everett and Haslund, and let's do a quick roll call vote, please.
I think you could do that by...
Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye.